that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God.
What exactly needs to happen for someone to be saved? This is going to be one of several videos I have planned, meant to explore the details of this concept of salvation. Now, being saved is a biblical term that refers to much more than being rescued from a terrible death or even being given a new life. It specifically refers to being saved from the penalty that all men deserve for their sin, separation from God and hell. The most well-known of all verses in the Bible, John 3:16, tells us that God loved the world so much that Jesus came to die to suffer the penalty for our sins. He came to save us. Romans 5 tells us that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So my question today is exactly what is it that makes us saved? Now, we know that it's the grace of God through the atoning death of Jesus on the cross that provides this salvation, but John 3:16 tells us that Jesus died for the sins of the world, and 1 John 2:2 tells us that Jesus didn't just pay for the sins of those who are saved, but also for the sins of the whole world. So, if we're going to take the Bible at its word and assume that it's true, because it is, then we have to answer this important question. If Jesus died to pay for everyone's sin, why is it that so many people will spend eternity in hell for their sin, while others spend eternity with God? If Christ died to offer salvation to everyone, what separates those who are saved from those who are not? Well, we know the answer, of course, is faith. Ephesians tells us that we are saved by the grace of God, but that grace is given through faith. It's kind of like turning on a light in your house on a dark night. What makes the room light up? Well, the power for the light comes from a power plant, but the room is lit up only when you flip the light switch. So, is the room lit up by the power plant or by the power switch? Well, the ability and power behind the lighting comes from the plant, but the power from the plant is not applied to that room until you turn the switch. In the same way, the power of salvation is the grace of God. It is Jesus who suffered for your sin to provide this saving power, but like the light switch, it is faith that makes the difference between where that power is applied and where it is not. In Romans 5, Paul puts it this way, saying that we are justified by faith because it is faith that grants us access to God's grace. So if salvation is available to all men, but only applied to those who believe, then what exactly must someone believe in order to be saved? This is an important question to ask because it gets at the heart of the experience of salvation. For instance, many people think that getting saved is all about praying a certain prayer. If you say the right words in the right order and really, really mean them, then you are saved. But that's really not correct. We are saved by the work of God, not our own work. We are simply responsible to believe, not to pray a certain prayer. I know many Christians who chose to believe in Christ as children, myself included. Did we really know enough to be saved? Isn't it kind of important that we know exactly what it is that we have to be believing in order to be saved? I mean, do we have to understand and believe the doctrine of the Trinity in order to be saved? That would rule out most children, right? Do we have to understand end times prophecy in order to be saved? That would kind of rule out everyone, I think, because no one really understands any of the doctrines of God to their full extent. But if not, what do we have to know and believe in order to be saved? Just the basics? But what are the basics? Well, there's a one-word answer to that question, but that one word will need a really good definition. The word is the gospel. This is the word that the apostles used in the first century to refer to the foundation for the Christian faith, the basics, that must be believed if one were to be saved. It is the one word that divides believers and unbelievers, because believers believe the gospel. Jesus even told the disciples before he left that it was their responsibility to go into all the world and preach this gospel. And Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15 that it's the gospel by which also ye are saved. So, if we want to know exactly what someone needs to believe in order to be saved, we just need to know exactly what is included in the gospel. The word gospel literally means good news, so it can be a bit generic, but Paul actually makes it pretty clear for us in 1 Corinthians 15. He says in verse 1 that he is going to declare the gospel to his readers. Then, after making the statement that it is through this gospel that we are saved, he goes on to describe exactly what this saving gospel is. How that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So I think we can break down Paul's definition of the gospel here and list exactly what someone needs to believe in order to be saved. The first in the list is pretty obvious, and that is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But there's definitely more to the gospel than just that. Notice that it says Christ died, using the title for Jesus that means that he was the Messiah of the Old Testament, the one that Isaiah said was called the Mighty God. What seems to be obvious here is that in order for someone to be saved, they must believe that Jesus, who died, was buried, and rose again, was in fact God. Now, I wouldn't go as far as to say that an individual must understand or assent to the complexities of the Trinity in order to be saved, but if they deny that Jesus is the Christ, the Mighty God, then they are not saved. Besides, how could anyone raise themselves from the dead if they weren't God? The resurrection really proves his deity, and anyone who believes the resurrection is going to have to believe in the deity of Christ if they're going to be intellectually honest with themselves. Then there's the end of that phrase, Christ died for our sins. So we can also add to this that to be saved, we must believe that we are sinners. This is pretty easy to guess because if we don't believe that we are sinners, then we won't see any need for salvation from the penalty for that sin. So it's no surprise that this is a requirement. Also, don't forget that the passage makes the statement twice that all of this happened according to the scriptures. So I think it's safe to say that if someone believes the gospel, they must also believe the accuracy and authority of the Word of God, the Scriptures. So, from 1 Corinthians 15, we can say that the gospel is exactly this, that Jesus is God, that we are sinners, and that the Bible is true, that Jesus as the Messiah paid for our sin by his death on the cross, he was buried, and then he rose from the dead 3 days later, proving that he was truly God and that our sin had truly been paid for. So then, can a young child truly be saved? Sure, if they at least have an understanding that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that they are sinners, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for their sin. What about a Unitarian? Can someone who disagrees about the Trinity be saved? Well, that depends. Do they still believe that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that they are sinners, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for their sin? But is faith really enough? Is knowing that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that I am a sinner, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for my sin, really all that needs to be believed in order for me to be saved? Well, yes and no. Is this simple gospel the entirety of what one must believe in order to be saved? Yes. But is knowing these facts of the gospel enough to say that you are saved? No. Knowing facts and choosing to place your faith in facts are two very different things. We use the word believe very broadly. For instance, let's say two men are sitting in a plane. The announcement comes that the plane is going to crash. They both believe that this is a factual statement. One of them puts on a parachute and the other does not. In the end, one is saved from the crash and the other is not. There is a difference between claiming a knowledge of the facts that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that you are a sinner, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for your sin, and actually choosing the salvation that Jesus offers because you believe that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that you are a sinner, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for your sin. That's why in Acts 8, Philip told the Ethiopian that he was a candidate for baptism only if he believed with all his heart. Because just knowing facts isn't enough. It must be a faith that you genuinely believe with your whole heart, a faith that James describes as a living faith as opposed to a dead faith. Now, if the man who died in the plane crash had believed with all his heart that the plane was going down and that his parachute would save him, then he would have naturally put on his parachute. And if a man genuinely believes that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, and that he is a sinner, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for his sin, then he will choose the salvation that Jesus purchased for him. It really all boils down to choice. Not that it is our choice that saves us, it is the work of Jesus that saves us, but he has ordained that that salvation be given only to those who choose it by faith. This is what is meant by the word repent in Scripture. When Peter said in Acts 2 that his audience needed to repent in order to be saved, he used a Greek word which literally means to change your mind or purpose. It means to turn from one way of thinking to a new way of thinking. In order to be saved, a man must believe that Jesus is God, that the Bible is true, that he is a sinner, and that Jesus died, was buried, and rose again for his sin. And he must also repent. He must choose to turn from all else and turn to Jesus for his salvation. Now, I know I've left a lot of questions unanswered here, so stay tuned. Next time, I'm planning a video on works and salvation. What must be done in order to be saved? Do you need to be baptized to be saved? Do you need to pray a prayer in order to be saved? Do you need to confess sin in order to be saved? Then, I want to make a video dealing with a really hard question. If Jesus died to purchase salvation for all, and only those who believe the gospel can be saved, then what happens to remote tribes of people who have never heard the gospel? How can Jesus have died for them, love them, and want them to be saved, and yet allow them to die never hearing the gospel if it is the gospel that is the only way for them to be saved? Stay tuned. I hope to have these out in the next few weeks. What do you think? Start the conversation in the comments below. If there's a question you have about the details of salvation, or maybe you just think I'm missing some important points, let me know about it in the comments. Now, before I go, I want to sincerely thank you for watching this video. If you like this content, don't forget to hit subscribe to support the channel and to see more content like this. I really appreciate it. Also, I want to remind you that the whole Bible is ultimately about one thing, the redemption of mankind by Jesus Christ. You see, the Bible teaches that all men are sinners and that no sinner can have eternal life with God in heaven because we must pay for our sins for eternity in hell. That's the bad news. But the good news is that Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sin on the cross. Since our sin has been paid for by Christ, all that is left for you to do is to accept that gift by faith. If you've never accepted the gift of God by faith, won't you do that today? Leave a comment or send me a message, and I'll be happy to talk to you more about having your sins forgiven by Jesus Christ.